Today, the Old Testament lesson is from Exodus 14, verses 19 to 31. The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. And then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove back the sea by a strong east wind all night, and turned the sea into dry land. And the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, and the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them. And all the Pharaoh's horses and chariots and chariot drivers, and at the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into a panic. He clogged the chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." And then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." And so Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. And as the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea, and the waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, and the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. And thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. And Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. And so the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses.
So our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew in the 18th chapter. Listen to God's word. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "If another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive them? As many as seven times?" And Jesus said to him, "No, not seven times. But I tell you, 77 times." And Jesus continued, "For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wishes to settle his accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought before him. And as he could not pay, the Lord ordered him to be sold, along with his wife and children and all his possessions, and the debt be paid. So the slave fell on his knees before the Lord and cried out, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And the Lord took pity on him and forgave him all the debt and released him. But when that slave's slave, as he went out, saw another slave who owed him 100 denarii, He seized him by the throat and said, "Pay what you owe." His fellow slave fell before him and said, "Have patience with me. I will pay you." But he refused. And he had him thrown into prison until he should pay the debt. Now, when his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went to the Lord and they reported all that had happened. Then the Lord summoned the slave and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had on you?" And in anger, the Lord handed him over to be tortured until all the debt was paid. So, my Heavenly Father will do to each one of you if you do not forgive your sister or your brother from your heart. The word of our Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, do grant that the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It's a familiar passage. In this passage, Peter asked Jesus a question that a lot of us would like to ask. How many times do I have to forgive someone? It's a vital question for a lot of people. How many times do you forgive someone who works for you before you hand them a pink slip? How many times do you forgive someone, a friend, before making final arrangements for another lunch? How many times do you forgive a marriage partner before you walk away from the relationship? How many times do you forgive a parent or an adult or a child or a brother or a sister before you wash your hands of them? How many times should I forgive? Peter asks. Peter says, 7 times? And Jesus answers, "No, not 7 times, but I tell you 77 times. Whoops. That's not the way I learned it way back in Sunday school. It was 70 times 7 back then. Well, this translation comes from the New Revised Standard Version, 77 times. Does this give us a new revised standard of forgiveness? A leaner, meaner standard of forgiveness? Does it mean that the good old days when you could count on someone forgiving you 490 times are over and now you only get 77 times of forgiveness? And then no more Mr. Nice Guy. Actually, the way the number is written in Greek is very ambiguous. And scholars for many years have fought over, is it 70 times 7 or is it 77 times? It's a respectable number no matter what. Jesus is basically saying, forgive and forgive and forgive. We all nod our heads and we say amen. And then we leave church and we still wonder how many more customers we can afford to lose from this salesman before we fire him. We still wonder how many more emotional outbursts from the boss we'll take before we find other work. We still wonder how many more times a loved one will come home drunk before we finally change the locks. We still wonder How many more times we can stand being belittled by an in-law before we stay away from family gatherings? The standard explanation doesn't help much, does it? Then we put that together with the parable that Jesus tells us about Peter, and we even get in deeper water. Now, I guess I'm supposed to tell you that this is a parable about God's incredible graciousness to us. It sure starts out that way. Jesus says that a kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who is going over his accounts and finds that one slave owes him 10,000 talents, which, as we'll see in a minute, is a pile of money. The slave promises to work hard, really hard, to pay it all back. Well, let me tell you what he's actually promising. Figure out what you would be promising. If your creditors came to you today and said to you, you have to pay off your credit card, you have to pay off your car loan, you have to pay off your mortgage and your home equity loan today, right now. How many of you could do that? And I'm not asking for a show of hands. Suppose you say, hey, I don't have that kind of cash laying around, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll pay you every penny of my income until I pay it off. Well, I don't know how I will eat or drink or pay for my heat or my water or my taxes, but I'll pay you every penny I make until I pay you everything I owe. Now, let's put this in terms we can understand. A person who owes $45,000 on their home, $4,500 on their car, and $500 on their credit card, and who makes about $25,000 a year, would take 2 years to pay off that debt, if you don't add any interest. At the average daily wage in the time of Jesus, it would take this slave almost 20 years to pay off one talent, and 200,000 years to pay off a debt of 10,000 talents. And you thought you were overextended. I don't think even the United States of America is in that much debt. Now, the king was touched by this kind of dedication. I will pay you back every penny, the slave promised. Here's a guy who's promising not just to work overtime, not just for the next couple of weekends, but for the next couple of ice ages. The king was so moved that he canceled the debt. Jesus says that the parable of the kingdom of heaven can be compared to that king. God's forgiven our debt, a debt that we could not pay off in 200,000 years. How many times have we heard that before about God? But the bigger question is, what difference does it make in our lives? The slave who had been forgiven this unimaginably huge amount leaves the king's palace and immediately runs into another slave who owes him the equivalent of about 4 months' pay. Now, that's not a small sum either, but it's much less than the debt that he owed and had just been forgiven. He demanded payment from his debtor, and his debtor pleads using the exact same words as the first slave. The slave isn't moved by this plea, and he throws the debtor into prison. Now, word of all this reaches the king. And the king, in anger, uncancels the debt and throws the first slave, who had only been saved by amazing grace, into prison also. And, in addition, that he be tortured until he pays the amount. Now remember, this is the guy who, even under the best of circumstances, would have to work 200,000 years to pay off his debt. Well, that's how the story ends. Not in mercy, but in vengeance. This is supposed to be a parable about forgiveness, but no one's forgiven.
And remember, the king who just ordered this terrible sentence of thousands of years of suffering is the very one to whom Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is not only like a king who forgives a huge debt, but also the kingdom of heaven is also like a king who exacts a terrible punishment for the sin of unforgiveness. And then Jesus himself pounds that point home. So, my heavenly Father will do to each one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from the heart. Now, I don't know about you, but that makes me a little uncomfortable. I thought this was the gospel. The good news, I don't get it. And that's the truth, I don't get it. The good news of the Gospel of Matthew, if it is good news, is that nobody gets it. Do you remember earlier this summer when we talked about the parable of the sower who sowed the seed and some fell on the path and the rocks and the thorns and the good ground? And his disciples asked him, Jesus, why do you speak everything in the form of parables? And Jesus answered, the reason I speak to them in parables is that seeing, they do not perceive, and hearing, they do not listen, nor do they understand. We're supposed to hear this parable about the king who forgives a huge debt and then exacts a terrible vengeance as good news. Do you hear it? Do you see it? What does it take to really understand this parable? A degree in ancient Greek, a good commentary that explains the various denominations of ancient Middle Eastern currency, a calculator that can multiply 70 times 7? I don't think so. What it takes to understand this parable is what it takes to understand all the parables. It takes looking into our hearts. What does it mean to forgive from the heart? Well, there's a simple way for each one of us to tell whether or not we've forgiven others. All we have to do is ask ourselves if we're free and if we're happy. Are you free to go anywhere with anyone? Are you happy? Or to use a more biblical word, do you feel joy? Some of us will say yes too quickly, just as we have said, I forgive you, too quickly. We say it because we think we're supposed to say it, because after all, a good Christian always forgives, and a good Christian is happy and free. Some of you are honest enough to say, no, I'm not really happy, not like the joy that I've been led to believe is a gift from God, and I'm not really free either. Well, there are some people that I don't like to be around. There are some people whose eyes I try to avoid. There are some places that I cannot go because they bring back very painful memories. Furthermore, some of you are wise enough to know that this is somehow connected to forgiveness. The wisdom that has come out of pain. Sometimes people will sit down with a friend or a counselor or a pastor and admit, I can't forgive. And that simple confession is the beginning of healing. I can't forgive. That isn't something most of us find easy to admit. Unless we can put our fingers on some kind of horrible thing that someone did to us, something that most people would say is unforgivable. A priest wrote in the Sojourner magazine about a little boy named Juanito who lived in an orphanage in San Salvador. He'd been found as a small child beneath the bullet-ridden body of his mother, his grandmother, and his three older brothers. The story said that he struggles each day to keep his spirits up, but he often spends entire days withdrawn, not speaking a word to anyone. One day after confession, Juanito put his hand on the priest's shoulder and said, "Pray for me. Pray for me, Father, so that I can forgive the soldiers who killed my mother and my brothers. I do not want to live with hatred in my heart." People like Juanito know that they have to forgive, or they will end up being entombed in a stone-cold prison for bitterness, tormented by the fire of rage, and that the rest of their lives, and maybe no, who knows, for eternity as well, that very pain will lead them to discover what forgiveness really is. But what about those of us who have not suffered any outrage, who are nevertheless imprisoned by our bitterness and tormented by our rage? Can we admit that we cannot forgive? Can we even say what it is and who it is that we need to forgive? Can we say why we are not happy or do not feel free? John Patton, in his book, Is Human Forgiveness Possible?, puts forth the idea of the lost contract. He says that we have contracts with other people. Some of them are explicit, like the marriage vows that many of us took. We all agree that when someone takes these vows and is unfaithful to his or her partner, the contract is broken. And in a sense, that person owes a debt to his or her partner. In Juanito's case, the breaking of the contract is very obvious, and everyone would agree that a debt is owed. We have a social contract that we will not take each other's lives. No one could ever pay back Juanito for what happened to him, for the loss of all his loved ones. Nevertheless, the soldiers owe him a debt. In other cases, the contracts might be in our hearts. We may not consciously know that we have such a contract, and we might deny it at first, but somewhere deep inside of us is a contract that our parents are always supposed to give us their full attention, that a spouse is never supposed to change careers, that a child was never supposed to grow up and leave home. That's silly, we say. That couldn't possibly be why I'm unhappy. We may even have a contract with life. Life is never supposed to be difficult. We're never supposed to grow old. We're certainly not supposed to die. And again, many of us sit there and say, "Well, that's silly. No one would think like that." Well, wait until you go to the doctor, and the doctor says that he doesn't like the look of the shadow on your x-ray, and you will see how silly that is. You may be surprised at how angry you are at life, or even at God. Forgiveness always lies on the other side of finding those hidden contracts, the debt that we've been collecting our whole entire life. Now, this sounds silly, but I know of a man who was secretly angry for 35 years because his mother forgot to make him a birthday cake on his 9th birthday. She owed him a birthday cake, and he never forgot. He spoke of it in a joking manner, but you could almost hear the bitterness and the hurt below his words. His mother owed him a debt of 100 denarii, and he put her in prison because she could not pay it back. In reality, though, he was the one in prison. His bitterness kept him from enjoying life, from enjoying his closest relationships. He was tortured by his anger. Sooner or later, we become so unhappy in our prison that we begin to examine our contracts, and we begin to ask ourselves about these debts. Some are very real, They're astronomical, and no one is ever going to be able to pay them back. There are other debts that are not real debts. When we examine our lost or our secret contracts, we see that we have been expecting other people to do what we have not been willing to do, or to be what we are not willing to be. There comes a time when a person finally says in his or her heart, "Nobody owes me anything." That's what it means to forgive from the heart. It often comes after months or maybe even years of pain. The pain forces us to find a way to end the pain. We finally figure out that the only way to end the pain is to let people off the hook, to cancel their debts. And peace is knowing deep in our hearts that nobody owes us anything. Our families don't owe us anything. Our church doesn't owe us anything. Our employer doesn't owe us anything. Our country doesn't owe us anything. Life itself doesn't owe us anything. And when we say, deep in our hearts, "Nobody owes me anything," the fires of torment cool, and the prison doors swing open, and we can walk free as men and women who know the secret of joy.